City of God. Till then, you can give it today or whatever, and those type of things, and just annotate with your name and your and all that, and just you know, the amount and your name, and it's going for the building, and we'll know what it is. That way, we're trying to keep those things separate, so we get a count of you know, just what comes in, and then we can give credit to who and what and all that other stuff. So anyway, we're going to be taking our special offering next week. Anything that is not annotated next week as tithes, missions, BBS, is all going to go to the insurance. Okay? So if you want, if you're giving something next week that's going to go to tithes, make sure that you put on that thing tithes. Because anything other than that will be going to the insurance. So anyway, that's all we have for this morning as far as announcements go.
Continuing song, turn to page number 116. Again, we'll sing 1, 2, and 4. Page 116.
He needed me, oh blessed thought, to the world with heavenly comfort brought. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for deepest gloom, sometimes where Eden bowers bloom, by water steer or troubled sea, still 'tis His hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me. And when my task on earth is done, when by Thy grace the victory's won, if death go away, I will not flee, since God through Jordan leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me.
Auditory hymn this morning, page number 363. Page 363, we'll sing all three verses. Let's all stand before we take our morning offering. Page 363.
Sing them over again to me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see, wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Christ the Blessed One gives to all wonderful words of life. Sinners to the loving call wonderful words of life. Also freely given, wooing us to heaven. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Sweetly echo the gospel call, wonderful words of life. Offer pardon and peace to all, wonderful words of life. Jesus, only Savior, sanctify forever. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life.
Oh, grace and heaven, Lord, thank you for the day, Lord. Just thank you for letting us give a little bit back to what you give us. Lord, the man told me this week, if you think it's hot here, what do you think it's going to be like in hell? I'm glad that by your blood, I don't have to worry about that. Lord, thank you for all you do for us and our church. Lord, we love you and trust in the name of our name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Just for me, he suffered.
prayer this morning, I ask you now just to open your hearts and your ears to what the Lord is going to do in this world.
You know, last week we concentrated in 2 Samuel chapter 22. We saw this David's song of praise, and we saw and we concentrated upon that God is, or the Lord is my rock. We concentrated on that rock that the Lord is. Well, this morning, you know, as we continue on, we see that the sun is beginning to sink in David's life. His praise for God, it continues to climb and to soar into the very heavens. 2 Samuel chapter 22 is like, you know, we were literally, how we could put this in these verses, we could literally say that they are like the snow cap that is on the mountaintop. You know, it's like icing on the cake. It is one of the key high points of the book of 2 Samuel is David's song of praise. And David, with confidence and commitment, he describes his relationship with the Lord without batting an eye. So take your Bibles this morning. Let's turn to 2 Samuel chapter 22. Verses 1 through 4 say, as we stand, as we read God's Word this morning, it says, "And David spake unto the Lord the words of this song in the day that the Lord had delivered him out of the hand of his enemies and out of the hand of Saul. And David said, The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. The God of my rock, in him will I trust. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my high tower and my refuge, my Savior. Thou savest me from violence." Verse 4 says, "I will call on the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, and so shall I be saved from mine enemies." Let us pray. Lord, we do come thanking you, Lord. Lord, we thank you for this song of praise as we are able to see it and to read it, Lord, as David sang it unto you. And Lord, I pray that you'd help us this morning to be able to see what you would have us to see out of this psalm, Lord. And Lord, if we do, we would forever be changed by what we have heard this morning. And it's with that that each and everyone standing said, Amen. You can be seated. We look at this and we must notice that David's words are spoken with concrete certainty as he begins to sing, "The Lord is my rock." There's no questioning in his voice. There's no questioning in his heart. He literally is certain that the Lord is his rock, and that it is the Lord that has delivered him. It is the Lord that will keep him safe. It is the Lord that will provide for him. David is singing this song of praise, and David is literally saying, "I possess him, and he is my life. He is my." We must also see that in verses 2 and 3, we find the word "my." is used some 9 different times as David reflects on the Lord. If we look at this, he says, the Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer, the God of my rock. He is my shield. He is the horn of my salvation, my high tower, my refuge, my Savior that saveth me from violence. All of these words, as we see how David is describing the Lord as he is singing this song of praise unto him, he is referencing the Lord in and through what he knows about him. He is literally proclaiming what the Lord is to him. And by the way, you know, we have to understand, as David is reflecting, you know, it ought to cause us to reflect. Is he in our lives? Is he your rock? Well, I give you, he can be, if you'll let him be that to you. You must make him your life and foundation for your life. And if you will, he will be that to you. We can look in 1 Corinthians in chapter 3 and in verse number 11. It says, for other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. You know, we need to make him the very foundation of our life. And then maybe, perhaps, if we do that, then we can have a song of praise like David is. And we can proclaim the things that David proclaimed about the Lord. How do you make Christ the very foundation of your life? Well, it all begins with a personal relationship. Trusting Him as your personal Lord and Savior. David says that the Lord is not only his rock, but he is also his fortress. His fortress. His stronghold, if you will. Back in over in Europe, there are, you'll find rivers and you'll find valleys and you'll find these things as they set and they lead into the way into a town or whatever the case is. And you'll find a fortress up on the hillside that guards the river that comes in to the town there. Because that's how the enemy would come. And that was the place where they could hold off. We find that in this, David says that the Lord is my fortress. So in him, we see this stronghold that protects and is protecting David. What literally does the Lord is my fortress? What does it imply? What is David trying to tell us? We must think about a fortress and then apply it to the Lord Jesus. If, you know, he proclaims, God is my rock, my fortress and my deliverer. We have to understand and we have to apply the things that we know about a fortress and apply those things to Jesus to get an idea of what he is trying to tell us. First, we have to see that as our fortress, he is our barrier of protection. Folks, do you understand this morning that nothing happens to us unless God allows? Nothing happens to you without God's consent. In Titus chapter 2, in verses 13 and 14, it says, "Who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity, and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee." Verse 13 up there, since I started in 14, it says, "Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity, purified to himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works." That word peculiar is formed from two Greek words, and they literally mean to be and around. To be around. So we get an idea as we see a circle, and as it surrounds a dot, we are surrounded by the Lord, and nothing touches us without his consent. People often wonder, and they'll say, "Well, what about all the things that happen that come our way?" Well, I'm telling you this morning that if God is our fortress, and we may wonder why the good things or bad things happen to good people, the answer is that God allowed it for their own good. In Romans chapter 8, verse 28, trials do several things for the believer. Do you know that you're probably thinking before you got saved, before you come unto the Lord, that, boy, when I get saved, man, life's going to be better. But have you ever noticed, like I've noticed, that life gets harder once you get saved? And it's because the devil wants to get a hold of you harder. Before you're saved, you're lost already. So the devil really has no interest in you. But once you get saved, he works harder to try to get to you. You know, we often look and we wonder, but I'm telling you this morning that trials do things for the believer. One, trials, they develop faith or character in the individual, like patience and faith, compassion, humility, and a dependence upon God. Man, you ever got to the point where you couldn't go any lower than what you got? The only thing that you have is to look up and seek God about it. You've done all that you can. Turn it over to him. Let him have. Second, trials, they help demonstrate our faith in the Lord. You know, there are people that are watching us. If we're proclaiming in the places we go, to the people we meet, and all these type of things, that we are, I'm a born-again Christian. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, when things come your way, people are looking. How's he going to react? Man, did you hear what's happening in, over there in their house or in their lives or to their family or whatever the case is? Man, the people are watching. They're watching how you're going to react. And if we stay steadfast in God, knowing to the fact that he is our rock, he is our fortress, that our faith will demonstrate to them the kind of God that we serve. Lastly, and it's not lastly, but it's the last one I have, trials, they develop future ministry in our lives. 2 Corinthians 1. Chapter number 1 in verses 3 and 4. It said, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforteth us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. When God provides for us a way, it is then that we are able to help others that may be in the same place we were in. And we can proclaim to them, God can help you. Because he helped me. That's our fortress. He is our place to retreat. I give you this morning that we can find security and rest in Christ when the storms of life are raging against us and our trials are overwhelming us. When those waves of the storms of our lives are just beating us to death, it seems like. When they come and they just sink us down to the bottom. I'm telling you that God is our fortress. He is the place in which we can retreat and safety. Satan is out to destroy us. And I give you this morning that he is a very real entity in this world. Ephesians 6 and in verse 12 says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against the powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Satan is seeking to destroy you. To destroy your witness. To destroy your testimony. To destroy your faith. But we can retreat to our Lord in prayer. And we can rest in the very promises of His Word. That's the reason when I saw this, it caused me to think, is His Word good enough? Is His Word good enough? If everything else was taken out of the church and all we had was just an old hard pew, would His Word be good enough? to draw us into his house. As our fortress, we can take our spiritual stand to resist Satan in the power and the protection of the Lord Jesus. If you go back to where we were in Ephesians just a second ago, in chapter 6 and in verses 10 and 11, it says, "Finally, my brethren," Paul writes, "be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil." I'm telling you this morning that God has enabled us to resist Satan. But it comes with the help of the Lord. We can't resist him on our own. But what we can do, we can trust in the Lord, because He is not only our rock, but He is our fortress. And if He is our fortress, our stronghold, our mighty high tower, then we can put on that whole armor of God that protects us. Is our fortress. Second Timothy chapter 1 and in verse 7 it says, "For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind." We are not to sit here and understand and realize that, oh my gosh, I'm so afraid of what life is doing to me. That's not for the child of God. That's not trusting Him as our rock, as our fortress, as our deliverer. But we must realize that He puts within us not fear, but He puts in us that spirit of power and of love. Our problem is that we don't use the power that God has put at our disposal to live for Him. Most of the time, we live life within ourselves. What we can do, what we can accomplish, what we can attempt, what we. David put it in another term when he says that God is my rock. He is my fortress. He is my deliverer. Those things come from a personal relationship, a personal belief in what God can do for us. Instead, we tend to dabble with temptation. We tend to drop our guard. We tend to develop inconsistencies in our lives instead of trusting in the very power that God has given us to use. As a soldier looks out from the wall of the fortress for the enemy, Christ helps us to be on the lookout as well. 2 Timothy, and in chapter 4, and in verse number 8, it says, henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Verse 5 says, but watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. Basically, what Paul is trying to tell us is that we need to take and understand and use what God has given us, and then tell others about what God has done for us. There are several things that we are to be on the lookout for. One, we're to be looking out for the second coming of Christ, according to Matthew 25 and verse 13. We are to be looking for His coming. We're not to be surprised when it gets here, but we ought to be looking for it every day. Looking for it. Because we don't have any idea when that day may come. Secondly, we need to look out for slothfulness and apathy in our lives. Are we doing all that we can do for the cause of Christ? Are we living up to what Christ did for us on Calvary's cross? Are we providing, are we being what the cross was intended for us to be? See, we ought to be looking. And when we see that slothfulness, that apathy pull up in our lives and park its ugly head in our lives, and what we need to do is turn around and kick it off. Kick it out of our lives. We need to be on the lookout for sinful snares and traps. Matthew 26 and verse 41. You know, the devil will use those sinful snares and those traps to trip us, to cause us to fall. He has no power against us because we have the power of God residing within our heart. But He will do what He can to make us to fall and to trip and to try to catch us. We need to be the lookout for satanic discouragement, depression, and destruction. 1 Peter 5:8 tells us that the devil walks around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And he'll devour the ones a lion would devour normally, the sick of the herd, those that are less likely to survive, achieve, or to fight him off. The devil does the same thing. He'll reach up and he'll try to strike us in our weakest moments, in our weakest places, in our weakest times. Because he's seeking to devour us. need to be on the lookout for stupidity and pride in our lives. According to 1 Corinthians 10, verse 12. Stupidity and pride. You know, there are times in our lives in which we will do some of the stupidest things. But it is in those moments, in those times, that's when Satan wants to try to get you. And in those moments, those instances of pride, when we look up and we say, boy, look at what I did. And we don't give any thought to what God was doing on our behalf. Lastly, the fortress is only as strong as its construction. It's only as strong as its construction. It'll only provide the security and the safety to how it's constructed. You know, we reference these type of things when we looked at the three little pigs last week. One built a house out of straw and the other out of sticks. And the old wolf, he huffed and he puffed, he blew their house down. Provided no safety. That third little pig, now, he took notice and he built his house out of bricks. And the old wolf, man, when he huffed and he puffed and he couldn't blow that house down. His fortress was strong because it had a strong foundation. It was constructed out of strong material. You know, our weak, unguarded place makes the fortress ineffective, and it leads to defeat. If the fortress is built poorly, it will not stand. It's like the house that was built upon the sand. And when the wind blew, the storm came, and the water beat against it, it fell. And the Bible says, and great was the fall of it. When it comes to Christ, strength and security are not a problem. You know, oftentimes I believe we forget just who we're talking to. But David, now David, he says he's my rock. He is my fortress, my deliverer. He looks and he understands that he is God. Christians are defeated because they open the door to enemies that will destroy them. They open the door. They just let them in. God delivered David from a lion, a bear, from Goliath, from Ish-bi-bi-bi, and from Saul. And I guarantee you that if he could deliver David from those things, he can be your deliverer as well. He can deliver you from whatever problem whatever circumstance, whatever trial, whatever storm, whatever wave is coming to beat you down, He can deliver you. Superman was alert to the needs of Lois Lane and Jimmy Olsen. You ever realize that? And whenever they got into a bind or something, he was always there. Well, I give you that the Lord is alert to our needs as well. Philippians 4. And in verse number 9, it says, those things which ye have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you. Verse 13 says, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. You know, folks, we got to understand just exactly what we have. David understood it. He saw what God had delivered him from, and he saw and he realized just exactly what God is to him. God was his rock, his fortress, his deliverer. David come to understand, like we need to understand, that just like the Calvary, the Lord comes at just the right time if we'll trust in Him. The Lord rescued Hagar with water in the desert. He rescued David when he was surrounded by Saul's army. The Lord protected Daniel in the lion's den. The Lord spared Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace. He rescued Lot from Sodom and Gomorrah. He freed Peter from prison on the night before his execution. Paul was spared from shipwrecks at sea. And the Lord is our deliverer from the penalty of sin, death, and hell. 2 Corinthians. Chapter 1, verse number 10. It says, who delivered us from so great a death, and doth deliver, in whom we trust that He will yet deliver us. Yeah. Man, if we could trust that in what He has already done for us, and in the things that He is doing for us, that He will do for us in the days to come. The Lord is our deliverer from temptation and sinful desires. There in 1 Corinthians in chapter 10. In verse 13, he says, there hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is what? Faithful. Who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. 2 Peter chapter 2 and in verse number 9. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptation and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. You know, when we think about it, we have one who is able. Notice it back in 2 Samuel in chapter 22. We have to notice the very song, and this is just the beginning of it. But it kind of sums up the rest of it. But he says here, and David spake unto the Lord the words of this song in the day that the Lord had delivered him out of the hand of all his enemies and out of the hand of Saul. And David said, the Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, the God of my rock. In Him will I trust. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my high tower, my refuge, my Savior. Thou savest me from violence. I will call on the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. Yeah. So shall I be saved from mine enemies. See, David had no problem in knowing in whom and what, where, and how his salvation came. It came from the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. David sang this song to him. It's nothing that the Lord didn't know already, but he likes to hear. Just as you and I, we love to hear from our kids, from our spouses, from those we care about, that they love us, they care about us. Well, we love to. David, in the same thing, was realizing that God likes to hear those things, that God likes to understand where and how and why and all these things that we feel about Him. And David said that He was my rock. He is my fortress. He is my deliverer. I don't know about you over here, but I know what I have. Boils down to realizing, is the Lord your deliverer? Is He your fortress of your life? Is He the one that you can seek shelter in when the storms come? You can seek safety in when troubles come your way. We must remember that is, it is not your hold on Christ that saves, but it is His hold on you that saves. David sang these praises unto the Lord. I believe the Lord wants to know if we'll sing those praises unto Him. Is His word enough? For His people to come together. Was the Lord enough for David? David's a man. He got a sinful nature, just like the rest of us. He had his moments. But I'm telling you that for David, the Lord was enough. Is he enough for you today? Is he enough? Is he your rock? Is he your fortress today? Is he your deliverer? Would his word be enough to bring you to his house? If that was all there was in this place. I believe for David it was enough. The Lord was enough. Let's all stand. Lord, we do come this morning. Lord, we come thanking you, Lord, for your many blessings. Lord, I pray that you would search us, O Lord. Lord, that you would see our heart today. Lord, can we truly say that you are our rock, our fortress in a time of trouble? You are our deliverer, Lord. Lord, I pray this morning that, Lord, as we've opened our minds and our hearts to you today, I hope that, Lord, that we would see that you're enough. You're enough, O Lord. And we would realize, if we look back upon the things and the charts of our lives, and maybe even where we stand today, Lord, we would realize that you have been our rock, that you've been our fortress, that you are our deliverer. And Lord, in the days to come, we would realize how truly, just what you truly mean to us. Lord, I pray this morning that through the very song of praise of David, Lord, that you would have spoken to our hearts today. And Lord, in this time of invitation, that you could be able to just let us contemplate upon what you have spoken to us. Lord, that we would open our hearts to be receptive. And Lord, if nothing else, that when we leave this place, we would realize just how good it was to be in the house of the Lord. And that your word is enough for our lives.
Page 451. Living below in his so sinful world, hardly a comfort to my soul. Striving alone, tender temptation sore, where could I go but to the
There were times in David's life he said, where am I going to go?
for my
and
soul.
Then it would realize in his soul that it
being
just the Lord.
A friend,
he's the rock that he could stand upon. He's the mighty fortress that would provide him security and safety. He would be the one that would deliver him. And he can deliver us as well. If we just trust him and proclaim him.
But when my soul
needs manna from above, where could I go but to the Lord? That he could go to none other but to the Lord. And he gave the Lord the credit as he sang praises unto him. I believe the Lord is seeking us to do the same. Is he your rock? Your fortress? Your deliverer? He can be. If we just trust him to be. Be back in Colossians this evening. So let's pray and we can be dismissed this morning. Lord, we do come. Lord, I thank you for allowing us to just come into your house this morning, Lord. Lord, just be with us as we leave this place, Lord. We go out of this sanctuary back out into the world in which we live. Lord, help us always to seek you as our rock and our fortress and our deliverer. Lord, help us to realize that the world has nothing for us but to try to destroy us. And we can trust only you, Lord, to protect us and to deliver us. Lord, I pray that as we leave this place today, we would realize that your word is enough to bring us unto you in this place. For it's in the name of Jesus that we do pray. Amen.